Christmas time here for Drop the Puck, and we're here at the Dragon's Den for some Christmas hockey for you. Of course, I've come dressed for the occasion.
You're looking very festive tonight, Dave.
I had a Toronto Maple Leafs hat somewhere, but I can't find it, so I've gone with the Green Bay Packers. But I'm back here with Gary, the enforcer, Chopper Lee. We haven't done an episode yet this season, Gary.
I don't think we have, no.
No? Here we are. Nice to see you.
Very nice to see you too.
Of course, here we are in the middle of a festive break for ourselves. But of course, no such luck for the Deeside Dragons. They come into tonight knowing that they've got an away game over the Christmas holidays, and then they're back here at Deeside straight after New Year's Day. It's a tough schedule for them over Christmas.
Well, it pretty much is, Dave, because normally Deeside don't normally play over Christmas. Very few games indeed. Historically, it's been detrimental to them in the past. But this time, maybe the change of playing the games over the Christmas period are going to be beneficial to them. Maybe it's a ring of change, but a good.
Hopefully, because what we saw against the Hull Jets last time on Drop the Puck was a really tough game against a team that was lowly ranked in the standings at the time. Of course, since then, they've been firing on all cylinders. Great game against Nottingham Lions last week. We said that was going to be a must-win game for the Dragons. 7-1 victory. Can't get better than that.
Well, of course, you've got to put it to Lowell and the Deeside management. The changes and adjustments they've made during the games have been really, really good. It's showing that by the way that they're performing on the ice. But of course, can't take away the fact that they're being led on the ice by a really, really good leader in the shape of Mark Lovell, who's been absolutely fantastic this season. The guy's only two off his total goal tally from what he was last season, and it's midway.
Yeah, veteran leader for the Deeside Dragons, and he's backed up by top goal scorers in Pallett, Super, Parsons, who's not at the game tonight. But you look at the Coventry Blaze, this is a team that's in rebuild mode. You're going to expect to see quite a bit of youth on the ice tonight, same as we saw last season. Gary, how does that affect the game?
Well, like you say, youth players. It's always great to see youth players coming through in any team. And Coventry have been a team that have been in like transition for the last 2 years. I mean, they're a former shadow of themselves, a great powerhouse at one time. This time, they've got players like Kerr and Morris who've got 6 and 7 goals each this season. But they've only got one win. And 6 and 7 goals, although they're quite capable, clearly, of putting it in the net, it's not enough at this level, and sitting bottom, it's not doing them any good whatsoever.
Of course, Coventry Blaze, what they lack is veterans, guys who are experienced at the game to come in, and part of that's to do with the transient nature of their roster. They are a team that is the feeder for a elite league setup, and they've got players who come and go. We saw only 2 years ago that they were playoff bound with a really strong squad. A lot of those players moved on, and in some respects it's been to their detriment.
It has really, and unfortunately, you can only do so much with a team, and experience does pay dividends in a squad like this. I mean, it's quite clear that from B-side's experience. This is a team that are on the up, and they're taking the ball by the horns, so to speak, and making it pay, whereas Coventry, they've still got a lot of work to do.
Will the Dragons come unstuck tonight against the Coventry Blaze? Nearly happened last time on Drop the Puck against the Hull Jets. Could happen against the bottom of the league. Will the Coventry Blaze awaken the force that's needed to beat the Deeside Dragons tonight? Only time will tell. It's time for us to drop the puck for Christmas. As we get set to drop the puck at the start of this game, and Gary, what's immediately evident to me is the size of the Coventry Blaze squad here tonight.
Yeah, it's a little disappointing that they've only travelled up so light, but it kind of emphasises the fact that they're sitting at the bottom and struggling.
Do you think part of the troubles as well is this is the Christmas holiday, it's going to be hard to get players to travel?
Well, I suppose you're right in one sense, but at the end of the day, if you're trying to develop a team, like we said on the intro, you need to get as many people up as you can.
Coventry Blaze with a shot that's deflected by the Deeside netminder. It's into the far corner. Knocked out. Morris has it. Deeks shot. And that's wide. Matty Compton's in net for the Deeside Dragons. And down the other end for Coventry, Graham Laverick, who's going to be tested tonight.
Certainly is, Dave. wouldn't like to be in that net at all.
Coventry pass it round behind the net. Bring it up from in the middle for a line change though. Missed the puck there. As Simon Furnival passes it to Philip Super. Brings it the other way. Shot. That was at a tight angle. Goaltender got a piece of that. Cleared by Coventry. Just held in at the blue line though by the Dragons. Stokes has to go back for it. Held behind his net. Plays it to Brooks. Again, just puck taken away by Deeside. Coventry struggling to get out of their own zone at this point. Finally do. Face off won by the Dragons. Trying to set something up here. They got Mark Lovell stationed in front of the net. Out of the corner comes Palak. Deeks. Nice mover is picked up by Morris. Turns it around the other way and Mark Lovell stops that. And as we say, Mark Lovell moved back to forward line earlier this season and it's done wonders for his stats.
Certainly has. It's this is a guy that's got commands his players on the field and everybody feels that he is when he's there. You can tell they perform well, they seem to get in the right place at the right time, and don't forget he's also a key shot himself.
Coventry tried to play it out. Brooks almost had it. The Dragons fire it down the other side. That's number 40 for Coventry. Gets it to Brooks. Dumps it in. Connor Keyes the other side of the net. They can't find a man. The Dragons get it back out. A loud crowd here for the Dragons tonight, ready to celebrate Christmas. And how much does it mean to the Dragons to go into a Christmas break 6 points up?
Well, you've got to look at last season where they so narrowly missed out. And when you're sitting on the top of the league looking down everybody else with the gap that they've got, and if you take a win tonight and be even more of a gap, then you've got to be confident going into next year, thinking that they've got to go all the way and take the title.
Of course, they've still got Witness Wild nipping at their heels as well as Nottingham, but Witness Wild don't play tonight. Good chance for the Dragons to cement their lead.
Of course, Witness are a team on the up. I mean, they're very, very prominent at the moment.
Nice shot there into the chest on Maddie Compton. Coventry win the face-off. Buckland plays it up front to Mackay. But it's picked off by Mark Lovell, who takes a shot. He's trying to get it past Andy Chappell, who was causing a deflection out front. And a backhander is almost in the net there. That was Palak. Backhanded wrist shot, almost fooled the goaltender. Another shot from Kennedy is off target. Jones couldn't keep that in. Morris comes back and Mackay, shot, ooh, is just stopped by the pads of Compton. Dragons from the face-off. Philip Super gets it to Ross Kennedy. He's going to take a shot. Almost beats the goaltender. Couldn't see that there. Parry was obscuring his view. And the Dragons doing a good job of getting a lot of traffic in front of that net, Gary.
They certainly are. The one thing Coventry can't afford to be doing is being camped in front of their own net. Deeside will punish them.
Super cross ice pass to Jones, who plays it back. Shot high, right into the glove of Laverick. Dragons. Matt Wainwright takes a shot onto the blocker of the netminder. Wainwright kept it in. There's nobody behind the net. Gives chance for the Blaze to clear, but again, no offense though. It's like they've come with a whole roster of defensive players today, Gary.
Certainly does. What this game needs right now is a goal.
And with only a minute and a half left in the first period, this has been a surprisingly even-paced game. Dragons have been all offense and Blaze have been all D.
Oh!
That was almost in though. Just deflected over the head of the netminder and went right over the goal itself. Almost spoke too soon. What have you got to do now to fire up either team, Gary?
A grenade in each changing room. That would be my solution. But of course, that's not the right one.
We're counting down the seconds now, just a few seconds remaining in the first period, and it remains surprisingly scoreless.
Dare I say it, Dave? It's almost as if they're trying to create damage limitations.
Well, we'll see how both teams answer this for the second period. Join us in just a few minutes. We'll be back with some more Drop the Puck. Puck has been dropped on the second period. Welcome back to Drop the Puck. And we're here for a game against Deeside Dragons and Coventry Blaze that so far, Gary, has been scoreless.
Yeah, surprise, surprise. I mean, we were saying earlier in the first period, Coventry have come here today and we said it so early as well, damage limitation. It's like their main objective today is not to let Deeside score.
Yeah, they're taking away the passing lanes in front of the net, which has been effective in keeping the Dragons out. And in return, though, they've failed to generate any offence, and that's evidenced by the shots on goal.
Yeah, I mean, Deeside, 25 shots in that first period to Coventry's 8, but it must be frustration for Deeside not being able to score.
Frustrating for the Dragons not to score, frustrating for the Coventry Blaze that they've not been able to score. I imagine both coaches had a lot of words for their players during that break.
Well, it's like I said earlier. If I was Coventry's coach, I'd be keeping up more of the same.
Morris gets it in front of the net. And he's held off two Dragons players for quite a while there. But it's back with Super, who's brought down. Manages to keep the puck though. Drops it back to Davis. Super couldn't keep it. Oh, but it's given back to him by Morris. Out front, tangled up in the skates of Spare. Coventry from the face-off. Kennedy quick on his skates there, just keeps it in. Dixon tries to help him. Tied up on the boards in front of the Dragons bench. Davis is in front of the net, and the Dragons are keeping a little further out of the crease than they were in the first period.
Certainly are. It's almost as if they're trying to draw Coventry out of their area, letting them play on the ice a bit, and then trying to catch them on the break with the speed.
We can certainly see there's been some adjustments made. Question is, how will Blaze adjust? As Chappell gets another nice shot, and a rebound from Davis goes high. Shot was brought out, but picked up by Louis Brindle, who dumps it on net. Compton covers. Cross ice pass. Blaze choose not to go for that. Chapel and Lovell. Pallet coming up the other side on the left wing. Turned around by Morris, but there was nobody there to help him. Lovell fans on the pat on the shot. And it looks like he got a stick into the face of the Coventry Blaze player there. That's Dale Buckland. He's had his fair share of scrapes in this game so far. And so the Coventry Blaze go on the power play. It's our first penalty of the game. Took 25 minutes to get there, Gary.
And purely accidental as well, I think. Just a bit of excitement on the ice. But other than that, a fairly clean game.
A Christmas truce maybe going on?
Well, we'll see.
Oh. Puck was loose in front of Compton and the Dragons quick to pounce on that. As number 22, Daniel Burton goes back. Gavin Austin plays it in. As the Blaze look to set up a play, they've still got a minute and 10 seconds left in their power play opportunity. Cross ice pass from Morris doesn't reach Louis Brindle. And it's knocked back out. They're going to chase again.
Well saved.
It's tied up in the skates. Chapel going back for it. Dragons have only got 30 seconds left to kill on this penalty. And so far the Blaze have not managed much offence. Can they get another shot here? They're setting up a play. Shot. Buckland, who's still on the ice, despite the stick to the face that looked pretty painful.
We're running out of time on this now.
Keep it in, and they've lost Palak, so it's 5-on-3. But no. The Dragons return to full strength. Lovell, Pollock shot, puck's loose, Pollock could have it again. And the puck's down into the Dragons' end as we've got an icing call. Morris with another shot. It was slightly wide. Gets it to McCabe, who couldn't keep it on his stick. And the Coventry Blaze, Gary, just seemingly dumping the puck in or taking shots from the blue line. They're not really taking a chance and taking the puck to the net.
No, it's a little strange. They are laying off quite a lot, which is it's an unusual tactic, especially against a team like Coventry, who theoretically you should be able to score against. But obviously 2 weeks ago they had that 9-1 thrashing Coventry against Deeside in their own backyard. They took a lot from that.
Parry. It's a Tasupa and Wainwright shot. It's up and it's in. It's a goal. Deeside Dragons finally on the board. It's Christmas time in Deeside, Gary, and there's no need to be afraid. Pollock was under pressure there. Soaked with the puck. And that was a shot. Pollock thinks that's in. Referee waved that off, and it looked like it either hit the post or hit the back of the net and flew out.
I don't think anybody's quite sure there, Dave. Referee behind the goals, not signalled anything.
Buckland in the corner, plays it out. Tries to get it to Brindle. Loses it, and the Dragons back on offence. Lovell Nice attempt. It looks like the referees have reversed their decision on the Adrian Pálak goal. And controversially, they're going to give it.
Strange state of affairs here, Dave.
We've got the footage. We'll replay that and see what we've caught.
It's clear that Buckland's not happy with the decision.
And to come a few minutes after, it's the strangest call I've ever seen.
Yeah, I must admit, it's not like they consulted each other at any point right afterwards. The game continued for a little bit.
Blaze looking to play it out now. But they just dump on net again and make a line change. Of course, Coventry Blaze playing with a little over two lines tonight, Gary. Only 11 men other than the netminders.
Well, that'll cost them later on in the games. They start getting tired. Those lineup changes are going to cost them.
Mark Lovell in the corner. Behind the net to Pálak. Looking for Chapel up front. Plays it back to Lovell instead. Pálak shot, and it's a goal for Adrian Pálak. Late in the second period, and the Dragons are now 3-0 up on the Coventry Blaze.
And who else would you expect to score other than Adrian Pálak?
And a player is down.
McKay's been slammed right into the boards there. And the fans are appreciating that. At this point, I always like to have a cup of coffee. We've got to do this more often. Having the cameras. We need the camera pointing at us. We need to get like a little plan.
Oh! So we have a 5-minute penalty assessed to Andy Chapel for the charging call there. He's got a game suspension. Our penalty is going to be served on his behalf. And Jack McKay has gone to the dressing room as well to get some medical attention. It was a rough hit. As the clock expires, the end of the third period, the second period, and it's been all go on the score front. It's 3-0 Deeside Dragons. We'll be back very shortly with part three. Welcome back to Drop the Puck, and we are set to drop said puck on the third period here at Deeside. In case you've just joined us, there was a late rout for the Dragons in the second period that's made this a 3-0 game. And Coventry Blaze, they've come out firing in the early goings here. Controversial second period goal, the second goal, which was awarded after the fact.
Some time after the fact.
We've had time to look at the footage during the intermission, Gary, and it did certainly look like a goal.
But it was the speed that it went in. It actually hit the metal frame and base of the goal and shot straight back out.
And if you're Coventry Blaze, it's all on you now. They need three goals to tie this up, and their offence has been lacking so far in the game. As McGrath plays it up front to Spare. Lovell just dumps it back out. We've got Andy Chappell sitting out a match penalty now for a cross check to the back during the second period. And the Dragons are still killing off a 5-minute penalty for that, 5-minute major. They're going to be killing that off in the next 3 minutes. As Buckland skates it in. Him and Morris trying to generate some offense. Shot. Nice attempt. Back up front of the net. Dragons clear. And it's a race to the finish, and Super gets there. Turn back around as number 22, that's Dan Burton, looks to get some offense. Up onto the chest of Super, and he couldn't keep hold of that. Stokes couldn't get it in. And now Buckland goes back to Roxburgh. As we saw, the Coventry Blaze changed their netminders in the second period. Halleck brings it in, shot. And we got a penalty being assessed to the Dragons now for a high stick. That's going to mean that the Deeside Dragons are down two men for the next 50 seconds. 5-on-3, this is a good opportunity for the Blaze.
Could be costly to Deeside this.
Morris, shot. Stokes was in front of that, but couldn't get a piece. Tries to clear, does. Dale Buckland, a little slow to get back there. He's taken a few bumps so far this game.
I think somebody needs to set the alarm clocks on Coventry bench, but they're not awake.
Costly bringing only 11 skaters to a game like this, when you know the Dragons have got such depth to their lines. They got one more opportunity before the 5-on-3 expires. Shot goes in and it's a goal! Just as the clock expires on that first penalty to Andy Chappell, Coventry Blaze find themselves on the board. Brought out front. Blaze tried to play it back, but poked away by Lovell. Plays it into his own zone. Cross ice pass. Matt Wainwright gets it onto the stick of Adrian Palak. And we see that Alex Parry has been moved up to that first line to replace Andy Chappell.
Yeah, they've obviously had to do a little shuffle round, make things work.
Morris back the other way, another shot.
Again, shots seem to be coming in a lot more now.
But still at a distance. You see what it took for Blaze to score, they had to get in close. They need to take some chances here, Gary. Jones. Shot from Davis. Looked like that was off the post. Pollock. Will he get it to Furnival? Taking his time.
Oh.
There was a nice pass to Mike Jones, but he couldn't make anything of it. And a nice shot from Davis as well. A slap shot there from the centre.
And it's that one man going upfield again, and Morris doing it all on his own.
Furnival drops it to Super. Knocked back to centre ice, and now Coventry Blaze. It's Morris back the other way. Blaze it up front to spare. And we've got a result in from second place Nottingham Lions. They were playing Hull Jets, who were a more than enough of a match for the Deeside Dragons on Drop the Puck last episode.
I must say, Dave, a bit of an interesting result.
Yeah, it was a Nottingham Hull draw.
Oh, we got another controversial goal again.
Looked like the helmet was knocked off the netminder. Are they going to award this a goal?
Goalkeeper, the referee seems to be tired as they're leaning on the net.
Shot.
And again.
As the Dragons have a lot of traffic in front of the net. And the puck is loose. But Morris. 3-on-2 the other way. Oh, couldn't clear it. Shot. Morris again. Mike Jones went down to block the shot there. Buckland from the point, shot.
Ooh.
Into the face mask of George Cox. And the Dragons fire back the other way. Lovell.
Oh, it's it.
1-2 with Adrian Pallett. Finds the back of the net. And the Deeside Dragons are on the scoreboard for the fourth time here tonight. So the Deeside Dragons further that lead now to 3 points as a goaltender comes right out of the net. Mike Jones was charging down on him there, and that was a dangerous move. Shot, and it's a goal straight off the face off Philip Super. And the Dragons extend their lead to 5-1.
And this is more like it now, Dave. Dragons making their move.
And a shorthanded goal, no less.
Very much so, yeah.
Shot from Pollock. As we now enter the final 2 minutes of this game. Pollock again, and it's a goal! Adrian Pollock, a man you just can't keep down.
That man again, Pollock.
Why did it take so long, Gary, for the Dragons to wake up to this game?
Well, obviously, prior to that controversial second goal, it's been a very, very defensive game from the point of view of Coventry, as we said early on. They basically were camped in their own third, and they weren't allowing anything in. They were trying to be obstructive to everything that Deeside put forward, and it was like damage limitations, but so early on. And I think it's the fact that they've come with such a small squad. They've not been performing very well. We've said it throughout the game that their final stick work has not been great. They're laying off the puck to the opposition rather than to their own players. And you can't expect the team to climb up the division playing hockey like that.
Still, they managed to hold the Dragons off for 25 minutes of this game quite successfully. But since then, Dragons 6 goals. I speak too soon. That's the 7th goal. Deeside Dragons.
Looks like Super.
So we enter the final few seconds of this period, Gary. Final few seconds of the game. And it's Eastside Dragons 7, Coventry Blaze 1.
What do you have to remember? Oh, and
here we go. Gary Dixon has dropped the gloves. And that looked like that came about as a result of a hit on Alan Roberts. Stay tuned for part 4. Kate Groves is going to be there with the coaches and players of the game for some post-match analysis. Don't go away.
We're here with Alex Parry, Deeside Dragons. Alex, how do you think the game went today?
I think it went pretty well. Took a while to get the first goal in, but after that, picked up pretty well, and I think we did pretty decent. 7-1, it's a good scoreline.
And that first goal was credited to yourself.
Yeah.
How do you feel to get the team motivated for that game?
Yeah, it's good, yeah. I feel awesome, yeah.
And having taken a break from Deeside, how does it feel to be back in the fold now?
Yeah, it feels good. I mean, I tried coming back a few times, to be honest, but yeah, I felt better this season and got into it a lot more and feeling good.
Alex, congratulations on the result today. We'll speak to you soon.
Thank you.
Mark Lovell, captain Deeside Dragons. How did that game go for you tonight?
To be honest, I thought, well, we started off pretty slow, I think, the first period. But we were getting our chances. I think we just didn't put our chances away. Their goalie played well in the first period. And I think we said to the lads, we just need to be patient and it will come in the end. And we proved that in the third period, finishing off 7-1. So, I mean, we would have liked to get a better start, but 7-1 win, 7-1 win. Take 2 points.
Gary and Dave spoke about you before the game and about your leadership and experience in hockey. Has it been pivotal to the performances so far this season?
I think yeah and no, but I think there's a lot of lads in the room that lead. There's some lads that have been playing hockey just as long as me, just because I'm the captain. I don't think it makes any difference, but there is a lot of leaders in the room. I just try and lead by example and hopefully lads will follow.
And do you think playing in a more advanced role this season has helped you gain confidence and momentum?
Yeah, I think so. I think we got off to a good start this season, as in the beginning of the season. We've kept it going. The lines have been pretty similar all year round, so I think that's helped as well. It's just consistent, which is what everyone needs, really.
Speaking of consistency, you've had some really encouraging results over the past few weeks. Can you use those results as we move on to the second half of the season?
Yeah, we need to, definitely. We've got to take confidence from it, because January, I think, is probably the biggest month that we're going to have all season. I think we play back-to-back for 3 weeks on the run. So I think if we come through January unbeaten, I think this might be so. I don't know, I'm not sure who we actually play in January, but I think the problem is now whoever comes and plays us or we go and play there, everyone ups their game. Everyone wants to put a scalp on the Deeside Dragons or against Red Hockey, whatever they want to say. So I think we've got to be ready for every game, and then I think if we get through January, that'll give us even more confidence to see us out the year.
Mark, well done on tonight's game and good luck with those
fixtures
coming up.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. We're here with Dale Buckland, Coventry Blaze. How do you feel that game went today?
To be honest, I thought the scoreline didn't really reflect the game. I think the last couple of goals, we were just tired. I mean, I think we shocked Deeside in the first. I think we shocked everyone. I don't think anyone thought we'd finish the period 0-0. But yeah, they're a good team. I'll be surprised if they don't win the league this year. I thought they showed why they're at the top of the league. So.
You certainly came here for a game today, as you said, in that first period, and you had a short bench. How does that impact on the squad?
I mean, you have to get on with it. I mean, if you have a bad shift, you've literally got 20, 30 seconds to get it out of your head because you're going up next. But I think everyone played well, from the goalies out. But yeah, having a short bench doesn't help. I mean, I think Deeside had maybe 20, 21 guys. But I think at times we pushed them down to just go in two-line hockey. So, I mean, we've got to take a lot. There's a lot more positives than negatives. I know we lost the game, but, I mean, there's a lot we can take from this.
One of the positives tonight was Mariah, and by the most MVP performance tonight.
I mean, Mariah's wicked. I mean, she's made GB under-18 girls. I mean, she's been training with us all year. She's a really good player. I mean, we called her up on the basis of we had a short bench. But I mean, after a performance like that, there's no reason why she shouldn't be pushing guys in the team for places.
Thank you for speaking to us. Good luck, and we'll speak to you soon.
Yeah, see you soon.
Thank you.
Bye bye.
Lol, great result tonight.
Yeah, another good result. Yeah, shame George never got a shutout because of the scrappy goal. But we had a slow start. We've had a massive amount of shots. I don't know how many shots we've had yet. I think our highest of the season is 72. I think we've probably done more than that tonight. But yeah, win's a win. A little bit scrappy at the start, but we finished well.
Again, another pivotal result. Last week you went away to Nottingham and got the same result, 7-1. How is these results going towards Deeside's future goals?
Well, we got our 100th goal tonight. Adrian Polak got the second goal in the game, which was the 100th goal of the season, which is fantastic for us because we were 98 coming in. I don't know who got the first goal, but the important one was the 100th goal, and he deserved it. So, yeah, we're getting a good goal tally up this season.
Speaking of Adrian, do you feel teams are isolating him?
Well, he's a star, isn't he? He's a fantastic hockey player, probably too good for our league. And if I was coaching any other team, I'd be saying stop Polak. So it's as simple as that, really.
Speaking of the game tonight, there was a controversial goal, the second goal, which was a goal, wasn't a goal, was a goal. We can confirm it was a goal. We've looked at our replays. Do you feel that's an argument for having three refs on the ice?
Well, in our league, we get what we're given. The rules are that you must have three refs, but a lot of the times with the movement around the country, the referees, they're coming from all over the place. You end up with two. We've seen it was an obvious goal. It's great to have the luxury of you guys filming the game to endorse that. And it took a few minutes, but it was great that we could go upstairs and someone could guarantee it was a goal and it was in. It was great.
Looking forward to the next few weeks. You've got a busy time ahead for Deeside. Are you still on track and are you looking forward to those games, particularly those double headers in January?
Well, we are on track. We have got six games through January. We're on track to the end of the year. On track to the end of the year was being top of the league. Tonight, after the win tonight, we're 6 points clear, top of the league. We've got no more games in hand on anyone, but 6 point gear is a good mark to throw down to the rest of the league. And I'm very happy with the way we're going. We approach every game as it comes, you know, and every game the same. Every game's a final for us. When you're top of the league, 6 points clear, everyone wants to beat you. So every game we go into, everyone steps their game up and wants to beat us.
Lol, thanks very much for speaking to us. Merry Christmas.
You too, Kate.
Wish all the best to the players.
Thanks very much. You too, you guys. Thank you.
A high scoring second and third period, but give Coventry Blaze their due. For the first 25 minutes of that game, they held Deeside Dragons off.
Well, I mean, that first period, Jose Mourinho would have been well impressed with that because Coventry camped the bus out right in front of that net. Deeside couldn't get anything past. Found it very, very difficult to do anything. Must have been really frustrating for them.
You could see that they were taking away the passing lanes. They were making sure that they were marking their men. Really great defensive play. Of course, the issue was they couldn't really get any offence on the go.
Not really, no. It was a struggle and it probably paid for that first period. It's sloppy, messy. It just wasn't attractive ice hockey at all. But then the second was a completely different ballgame.
Well, of course, Deeside Dragons adjust in the second period. You start to see the lanes open up a little more. Less guys camped out in front of the net and taking chances around the net instead. And it started to pay off for them.
Well, you could see that something had been done, the changes, because it opened up the whole game. Deeside were dropping off a little bit more, allowing a bit more space for Coventry to come out and play a bit more hockey, which allowed Deeside to move the puck around a little bit and obviously try and use their speed to try and get up and score and make a goal on the counter-attack. But obviously they only managed to get one before we had that little bit of an incident.
Yeah, the controversial call there. And as Lol Paul, coach of the Deeside Dragons, said, how much of this comes down to having a two-man referee crew instead of the usual three- or four-man crew?
Well, it was detrimental. I mean, the strange thing about it was the amount of delay between the actual goal and the actual decision overturned. But I know it's low-league-level hockey, but in games like this where you don't get Hawkeye technology and stuff like that, a third eye, or third pair of eyes, should we say, is very important. And that extra man, especially when you've got a puck flying up and down the ice, the speed it does, you've got to have somebody that's able to catch that, and a third person certainly would have helped today.
third period, you've got the Dragons, guys like Adrian Pallock, doing what they do so well, and of course, proves costly. Coventry Blaze down to only two and a bit lines, really, came short, benched, and of course, players end up running out of steam.
Well, you've got to remember, it was only 2 weeks ago that Coventry played D-side and lost 9-1. And it's quite clear they came here with the plan today, not having a result, a similar result. Hence why they camped the bus out in the first period. And it seemed to do quite well for a while. But like you say, you've got a very high impact team in D-side. Constant line changes, adjustments they were making. And it just wore them down. You come here with 11 players, 13 players. It's going to take its toll over the time. You're just going to wear you down. You're going to get tired. And you've got to remember, there's not a lot of experienced players out in the Coventry side now. You've got Buckland in there, who did a grand job commanding what players he had there. But there were a lot of youth. And, you know, Morris was one of the outstanding players in my eyes. The guy was on his own up front. And when you've only got people behind you, you've not got people feeding you in from the sides and stuff like that, it's difficult to be a one-man team. And you can't expect them to score all the time.
Of course, Coventry Blaze are back with us on the next episode of Drop the Puck in the new year. They're back in the D-side Dragons' den here. So hopefully we're going to see an adjustment there and more of a competitive game for the full three periods. But until then, if you haven't seen the Bench Warmers Christmas special that we put together, you've got that on YouTube. Make sure you go onto Facebook and Twitter, look up BASN Radio. You'll find the Bench Warmers Christmas special there. We'll be talking about the NHL Winter Classic, the NBA Christmas games, the NFL season so far, and of course, the big college football game. So make sure you catch that. But that's all for 2015 here on Drop the Puck. Make sure you join us in the new year. Until then, hope you've had a great Christmas and a happy new year.
Merry Christmas.